Good morning. I'll say this. He is risen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand and we'll sing, "Come People of the Risen King."
Happy Resurrection Day. He is risen. Our call to worship today is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 4. "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures." Amen.
Thank you.
Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. As they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise."
Christ is risen, he is risen indeed.
Preach the truth, the power of grace. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Winthrop Street Baptist Church. My name is Grant, one of the pastors here. As God has made us family, let's go and greet one another's family. Good opportunity to meet someone this morning.
Said good morning, and my voice went. It was like,
oh. I have tea with honey right here, so I'm like sipping every time I get.
That's it.
All right, let's grab a seat. Well, again, everyone, good morning and happy Easter. It's good to be together. He is risen. There we go. Amen. Well, hey, once again, happy Easter. It's great to have you all here. Those of you that are here every week, or maybe it's your first time, or maybe you've been a couple times over the years, it's good to have you here with us this morning. Really, we encourage you, get to know people. That's why we spend time greeting one another. We believe that Christ's death and resurrection has made us family. And so spending time together, getting to know each other, and how Christ and the gospel of Jesus has changed our lives, that's what it's all about. So it's good to be together. If you're new here, myself or Pastor Pete, we'd love to get to know you afterwards. Feel free to find us afterwards. We'd love to talk to you. Two other short, brief announcements for us. Number one, for those of you that have been joining in the evangelism class, you can expect we are taking a pause today for Easter. We'll be back on next week after service. And then if you're interested in getting involved and like, oh, this is good. These people aren't too bad. Would love for you to come to community groups. It's a great place to plug in and really just get to know people in the church in a low expectation, high gain setting. We have food. We talk about the sermon from Sunday and pray together. It's really a great time. Those are every Thursday night at 6:30. So there's a QR code on the bulletin if you want to sign up that way, or you can find me after the service and I can help get you connected to one of those groups and give you more details. But it's a really great opportunity to get involved. And people in this church make really good food. So that's a good reason to come, if nothing else. All right, with that said, guys, we made it. We've been going through the Gospel of Mark for quite some time. Today's our final day in Mark. So we're going to read Mark 16, verses 1 through 8. Mark 16, 1 to 8. To read God's word. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on, the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is God's word. Let's pray together. Amen. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for these words in the Gospel of Mark that remind us and point us to the truth and the fact that Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. They went to the tomb and you were not there. Because the work of redemption was being complete with your resurrection and ascension to the Father's side. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you that you were not there. We thank you that this is proof concept that you, Jesus, are Lord and King, and in you there is hope for life, redemption, and salvation in your name. Lord, we rejoice today. We thank you today. We thank you, Lord, for the life that can be found in Jesus that this world does not offer us. We thank you, Lord, that there can be purpose and meaning in this life because of you and your name, that we can honor you and love and serve others because you have loved and served us, so that we might honor you with our lives, our actions, and our words. Pray, God, that this morning those of us that know you will be encouraged and built up in our faith, and those that don't know you will take time to really consider what we're talking about here and what your most, more importantly, what your word, your truth is talking about here. We pray, God, for churches all over the world meeting today, for people that might not ordinarily hear your word preached, that they'll be convicted, challenged, built up, and Lord, ultimately, that many will be saved today in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, that many will be added to your number today. We praise you, Lord. May this morning be honoring to your name, and that's really what it's all about. So we thank you, Lord, for this time together. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to bring the kids up right now for a little bit of kids' Easter worship.
alive, shout Hosanna, Hosanna. Jesus is alive, Jesus is alive, Jesus is alive, shout Hosanna, Hosanna. Here comes Jesus rising up in glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. He's alive, let's tell the world the story. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King.
Precious.
Definitely not topping that. So.
No, we got to follow that now, right? Need some guitar. Here it is. Let's all stand and let's sing the gospel that we all believe. And if you don't,
good morning. Welcome to Winthrop Street Baptist Church. My name is Pete. I'm one of the pastors here. Oh, kids can be dismissed if they haven't been already. I feel like the kids, they get incrementally better each year as it goes by. The one kid that was right here that was kind of distracted and dancing, that was my son, you know. He got his moves from me. Can't lie. So Mark chapter 16 is where we'll be here this morning. When I was in school, high school, and college, I struggled with teachers who were long-winded. Anyone identify with that? I feel like all of us could. I found that I got way too distracted to pay attention for long periods of time. Ironic that I ended up becoming a preacher, where most Sundays I preach sermons that are 35 to 45 minutes. I wanted my teachers to get to the point, get to the bottom line. Tell me the most important facts that I need to know so I can study them, take the test, pass the class, move on in school, and then forget those facts, right? I think many of us want the bottom line when it comes to Christianity. We have the Bible, but this is a big book. So what's the main point? So let me tell you this morning, it's simple. The main point of the Bible and Christianity is this: the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what we stand upon as followers of Christ. Because if the resurrection is true, then all the other facts are true. It means that there's a God, that Jesus is that God, that the Bible is true, which means that heaven and hell are real places, and Jesus makes the difference as to whether you will go to one or the other. See, Christianity stands or falls on the historical, bodily resurrection of Jesus from the dead. If there's no resurrection, then there's no Christianity. This is what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17. He says, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. See, the bottom line of Christianity is this: the resurrected Jesus Christ. And so we declare this morning that Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. I'm going to train you guys for Easter Sunday. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. And Mark 16, 1 through 8, is going to show us this rock-solid evidence about the most fundamental truth and fundamental issue with the Christian faith, so that we can be sure that our faith is not futile and that our faith in Jesus is not in vain, and that we are no longer in our sins, but we have been forgiven by God, so that we can sing that song and declare with confidence that Christ is risen. Gotta train you guys. We awake? We have too many pancakes or something? Let's pray. We'll get into God's word. Lord God, we praise you for your plan of salvation. We praise you, God, that you rose Jesus from the grave, and he is now ruling and reigning, enthroned in glory. And we stand here in submission to you, Jesus, our great King, Lord, and Savior. I pray this morning that the words of my mouth and meditations of all of our hearts would be pleasing in your sight, for you, Lord, are our great rock and our Redeemer, and it's in your mighty name that we pray. Amen. Amen. So this Easter morning, we're going to identify something kind of counterintuitive. We're going to see unbelieving love. Let me parse that out for you. We see women, they go to the grave of Jesus, and we see unbelieving love. See, Mark has established that we've been working through Mark's gospel. These are the same women who saw Jesus suffer and die on the cross, which is what Mark 15, verse 40 says. These are the same women in Mark 15, 47 who identify where Jesus was buried, and Mark describes what these women do next. Look at verse 1 in Mark 16. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on in the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb? So look at what these women do. They wake up early in the morning, leave their homes once the Sabbath was over, and they go to anoint the body of Jesus. They saw him die. They knew where his body was laid and buried, and so they went as a display, as a final act of love to Jesus. They didn't have any idea of the resurrection in their minds. Their biggest concern was for the stone that covered the entrance. Now, the tomb of Jesus, we don't know exactly where it was, but it was essentially a cave that had hollowed out shelves to lay the bodies on. The entrances were mostly covered with large stones. Most of the poor people in the society had large square stones to protect the tombs from grave robbers. But a rich family, like Joseph of Arimathea, which we saw was the one who arranged for Jesus to be buried in his own tomb, had a circular stone that was laid up against the entrance. The round stone was rolled and dropped into a groove in the rock at the front of the tomb so that it could then be lifted up and rolled out again. The women had a problem. You see it in verse 4? Or verse 3? No, verse 4, sorry. Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb? They knew they weren't strong enough, and all the male disciples of Jesus were in hiding, so they were of no use. The women had devotion, but it was misguided. Yes, these women are very caring, very loving, very thoughtful to minister to the needs of Jesus. but they didn't listen to what Jesus had plainly said. He said three times in Mark 8, Mark 9, and Mark 10 that they were going up to Jerusalem where he would die by crucifixion and where he would raise back to life on the third day. They had ignored that. They didn't have a category for the resurrection. And then even in Mark 14, just a few days previously, Jesus was anointed in the upper room by a woman just a few days ago. And in Mark 14, Jesus said about the woman who had done this, "She has done what she could. She has anointed my body for burial, for my body beforehand for burial." See, Jesus was going to rise again. He knew what was going to happen. He'd already said that his body had been anointed for burial. There was no need for grave clothes. There was no need for the ointments or spices to embalm him. So these women had unbelieving love to make them think that they needed to do the burial rituals. Their hearts were in some ways genuine, but not guided by the truth. And isn't that all of us to a certain extent? Our hearts are genuine, but not always guided by the truth. And I think if this may be your first time in church ever, or even in a long time, your heart is genuine. You see the need for being at church on Easter Sunday. But you may not be guided by the truth. Because the truth is, you don't only need Jesus on Easter Sunday. You need Jesus each and every day of your life. And you need Jesus to be active and present in your life, and you need to be part of a church that celebrates the resurrection of Jesus every Sunday. That's why we meet every Sunday morning, to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, not just on Easter Sunday, but every single week. You know, there's a temptation for all of us to just come to church on Easter or even any other Sunday and sing for Jesus, but then go home and live however we want. You know, there's a familiar illustration that oftentimes pastors use to describe believers who come to church but then don't come back for a while. Think of a fire, a campfire. You know, this is actually perfect weather to have a campfire today. So let's say hypothetically you put a big log in the campfire. What's going to happen if you pull that log out? Is it going to stay on fire? Maybe for a little bit. Eventually, the flame will go out. And in the same way, that applies to us as believers. When we come to church, it's like a flame, you know? You got the pastor saying, "Christ is risen." You know, you get encouraged, you get excited, you sing, you laugh, you rejoice in the grace of God and what he's done for you. But then when you go home, what are you bombarded by? Temptations, sin, the same old world that we live in. See, we need each other. We can't live on our own as believers. Christians cannot exist in isolation. We need each other to follow Christ together. Because this is the truth that we need to hear. The death and resurrection of Jesus changes our views on reality. It changes our whole lives. It means that we don't live for ourselves, but we live a life out of love and devotion for Jesus Christ, who is our Savior and King of the universe. And if we don't live for Jesus, then we're living a life that's flawed, a plan that's doomed to fail, like these women who were going to the tomb with a stone they knew they couldn't move. What were they going to do? Well, the answer comes to the woman's question in verse 4. So we see their unbelieving love, and now let's look at the unbelievable fact. We're introduced to this unbelievable fact. This is where I geek out in the sermon. Here's the unbelievable fact. It's not that the Mariana Trench is almost 7 miles deep. Try to think about that for a second. It's not that pineapples take 2 years to grow. Isn't that crazy? You have pineapple the other day? 2 years for that thing. It's not that armadillos are bulletproof. Don't try that one. Don't test that. The unbelievable fact is this: Jesus Christ was raised from the grave. Amen. That's the unbelievable fact. Look at verse 4. And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. I mean, just imagine that you're these women, that you go to the tomb, you don't see the stone rolled there, you see it rolled aside, and you see, you go into the tomb, and you see a young man sitting there where the body should be. I assume their hearts probably started to pound. They were probably wondering, did someone steal the body of Jesus? Is someone really desecrating him? And so they courageously enter the tomb and they see this young man dressed in a white robe. This young man was an angel wearing dazzling apparel, and the women were alarmed. In an instant, they had fear and wonder and amazement, astonishment and distress all entered their hearts in that one moment. And this is where skeptics say the Bible doesn't agree on the account of the resurrection. Because two Gospels, Luke and John, say that there were two angels present. But Matthew and Mark, they only focus on the angel who spoke with the women. But this is not a disagreement. This is not a contradiction. Because if there's two angels, then that means there's also one angel there too, logically. It's just that Matthew and Mark say they just describe the angel who spoke to the women. They don't say there was only one angel. They just say they describe the events of what the angel said. So here's what Mark says. The angel knew the women were in distress, and so he tries to calm them down and reveal the unbelievable fact to them. Look at verse 6. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him." So the angel says, the crucified one, Jesus of Nazareth, has risen. And that phrase, "he has risen," is in the passive form, which is better translated as, "he has been raised." And this is an important nuance, because there's a difference between "he has risen" and "he has been raised." See, Jesus laid down his life, he can take it back up, but it was God the Father who raised him from the grave as a vindication of and acceptance of the perfect once-for-all sacrifice for sins. He has risen kind of implies that Jesus came back to life on his own. But he has been raised reveals that God the Father raised the Son from the dead. And just as God rolled the stone from the tomb, God raised Jesus from the grave. You see, salvation belongs to the Lord. Salvation belongs to God Almighty, and God Almighty rose Jesus from the grave. You see, God accomplishes every single detail of our salvation, and he fulfills his plan for giving salvation to those who trust in him to the smallest degree. You see, it's no surprise that you're here this morning on Easter to hear God's word and to hear the gospel. God drew you here so that you would hear the truth, so that you would believe and trust and follow Jesus. God is that providential. He loves you that much. He cares for you that much, so that you could hear, see, and believe in who Christ is and what he's done for you. Back in the tomb, the angel points the women to the last place they saw the body of Jesus. And Mark references the place of his burial and to Jesus as the crucified one. Then that's important. Look at what happens again. The women are directed specifically to Jesus, to him who died by a crucifixion, which they witnessed, they saw with their own eyes. They saw then where he was buried in a place that they witnessed, and now they're the same very witnesses who are seeing that he's been resurrected. He's not here. He's alive. So Mark 16, verse 6, refers to both sides of the Easter event, the death and resurrection of Jesus, the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ. And this is the connection between the historical Jesus who was crucified and the resurrected Jesus, which is a beautiful announcement of the gospel truth. So the angel invites the women to know the truth. They no longer need to have unbelieving love. Now they can believe in this unbelievable fact. And this is the proclamation of good news. The good news is the gospel. And this is the gospel. And from this place, the gospel is first preached from the empty tomb, that the crucified Jesus was buried, and he's now raised to life again. And the evidence is undeniable. You see, every theory, both ancient and modern, all objections to the resurrection of Jesus, they're crushed by this one question. What happened to the body of Jesus? Even the most extreme skeptics don't deny that the grave was empty. Matthew 28 says that the chief priests, they paid off the guards at the tomb to spread the lie that the disciples of Jesus came by and stole his body at night while the guards were asleep. But the Jews didn't have the body. The disciples didn't have the body. If the Jews had the body, they would produce it immediately and say, no, here it is. This is Jesus. And if the disciples had the body, you think they would have died as martyrs? I don't think so. There would be no advantage for the disciples to spread the lie that Jesus had risen again, because their lives would then be at risk for believing in Jesus. But the disciples were convinced that Jesus has risen from the grave because he did. He did. And so if someone says, I don't believe in the resurrection, ask them, then where's the body? Where's the proof? But look at the angel continues speaking to the women. Look at verse 7. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he's going before you to Galilee, and there you will see him just as he told you. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. So the women are given the task to go tell the disciples and Peter that Jesus was going to meet them in Galilee, just as Jesus had said earlier in Mark 14:28, where he says, but after I'm raised up, I will go before you to Galilee. Again, Jesus predicted he would be raised up by God and meet them in Galilee. And the angel identifies Peter. So just try to imagine what Peter had felt here. Peter famously denied Jesus 3 times. He let his Lord down repeatedly. He said he would die with Jesus, and he failed. And now the angel wants to make sure that Peter is told that Jesus is not dead. What a beautiful portrait of redemption. You know, I'm sure that there's some people here, many of us think that our failures, our sin against God could never be forgiven. I'm sure that's what Peter felt. But here's proof that there is redemption for anyone who calls on the name of Jesus by faith. That God will forgive any and all sins through the work of Jesus for us. And so the women, they left the tomb. They were trembling. They were astonished. I mean, put yourself in their shoes. They left the tomb. They were silent because they were afraid. And with that, Mark's gospel comes to an end. What an interesting way to end a gospel, right? The ending is so abrupt, but it fits perfectly. Because we've seen this theme of fear and amazement all throughout Mark's gospel. And I think the response of the women just reveals how authentic Mark's gospel is. Like, if we were to invent a story, it probably wouldn't end like this. But we know that in Mark and his gospel, fear is always man's response to the breaking in of the power of God. So think back a couple, well, almost a year now. Think back to Mark 4 with the disciples who were on the boat with Jesus, and the storm is raging, and Jesus calms the storm, and the disciples' fear increases because they realize who Jesus is. Think of the people who saw Jesus cast out a legion of demons and send them into pigs. They were fearful because of the power that they saw in Christ. Think of the disciples who were fearful and amazed as they saw Jesus setting his face to Jerusalem, where he would die on the cross. You see, fear is the response of men and women that Jesus shows his power to as the Son of God. So fear is actually kind of a perfect way to end Mark's gospel. It makes it clear that the disciples of Jesus, they were stunned by this. They were amazed at this. They didn't expect the resurrection, and they didn't know how to respond. How would they respond to all of this? This is almost how Mark ends it. And more importantly, for his original readers and for us today, how will you and I respond to the resurrection of Jesus? There's three options that people tend to have about the bodily resurrection of Jesus. The first option is that they say the resurrection is false. It was a hoax. Jesus didn't rise from the dead. The disciples just made up the story and pulled off the greatest con ever. The second theory that people have is that the resurrection of Jesus is fiction, just an ancient myth that just over time the early church made up, and then it just turned into what it is today. But I think the third option is the most plausible, that the resurrection of Jesus is fact, and it's the most important event in human history, that the New Testament accurately records the historical and supernatural resurrection of Jesus from the dead. That's what I think is most plausible. So just for a minute, let me go through some of the other theories that people hold on to try to explain away the resurrection of Jesus. Some of them are actually kind of funny. The first theory that people have is that Jesus didn't really die, but he just fainted. He fainted from the physical punishment that he endured, and then after 3 days, somehow came back to life. That doesn't make any sense. The Romans knew how to kill people. They were actually really good at that. Jesus was dead. The second theory is that Jesus wasn't raised bodily, but he returned in a spirit form. Again, that doesn't make sense because there's accounts of Jesus being touched by his disciples and eating fish with his disciples. The third, I think, is funny. The third theory is that the disciples all suffered from a mass hallucination, that Jesus hypnotized his disciples on earth so that after he died, there would be certain cues that would happen that would make them think they were seeing him. People believe this, that are actually like somewhat educated or smart or whatever, I don't know. And it's ridiculous, right? There's other theories that say it was a myth, that the body was stolen, that the women went to the wrong tomb, that the women and the disciples, they misidentified Jesus. Some say that Jesus had an identical twin brother for his whole life that all of a sudden appeared at the cross, or appeared after the resurrection, after Jesus died, claiming to be him. Like, Muslims say that Jesus didn't actually die on the cross, but that another person died in his place. I mean, this is what the unbelieving world says about the resurrection. So what do we say that? What do we say to those things? What is the evidence that we have for the resurrection? Well, the first evidence is that all the other theories are ridiculous, right? The arguments don't hold up. The second reason, second evidence, is that we look at the disciples. We see a radical change in their lives. They go from being marked by fear to being marked by faith because they had met the risen Jesus. And that changed them from fearful cowards to bold witnesses of the resurrected Christ. You see, 11 of the apostles died as martyrs, still proclaiming Jesus as the risen Lord unto their death. You know, people may die for a lie if they think it's the truth, but people won't die for what they know to be a lie. You know what I mean? The third evidence that we have is that the resurrection relies on the testimony of women. And at this point, in Jewish culture, the testimony of women was not even admissible in court. But women are the ones who give the testimony of the empty tomb. This could be embarrassing for the church, but it shows that the account was not made up. If they made it up, they would have made up something different. But it was described this way and recorded this way because this is what actually happened. The fourth evidence that we have is the many records of the post-resurrection appearances of Jesus to his followers, culminating in the ascension of Jesus back to heaven. And there's many more evidences that we don't have the time to address, like the 5,800 Greek manuscripts of the New Testament, the writings of the eyewitnesses to the resurrected Jesus, the conversion of the brother of Jesus, I think he would identify who his brother was, and he actually believed that his brother was who he said he was, the Son of God. I mean, imagine that your brother says he's God. What are you going to think? Imagine that you see him die and then come back to life. I think that's actually evidence and proof that it actually happened. And we could go on with more evidences. But let me close with this. Why is the resurrection important? I'll give you two reasons. The resurrection confirms the deity of Jesus Christ. He's God. And second, the resurrection provides hope for us as believers in the resurrection. The resurrection tells us that the God who raised Jesus from the dead exists, and it establishes and confirms the lordship of Jesus Christ as the Lord of the universe, the King of creation, the sovereign one over all things. See, Jesus is the first one to resurrect from the grave. And what happens to Jesus happens to us who believe in him. This is the beauty of faith in Christ. We see in Jesus that he came from heaven to earth to provide for us a way to go from earth to heaven. He's the one who broke the barrier between earth and heaven as the God-man, so that you and I, by faith, can enter into God's presence and be justified. This is what Romans chapter 4, verse 25 says. Romans chapter 4, verse 25 says that Jesus was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. It's an important phrase and sentence. Our salvation rests on the resurrection of Jesus, who was raised to life so that you and I would be justified by faith in Christ. To be justified means that we're declared righteous, that even though we're guilty, we're condemned in God's law courtroom, as God is the judge and we're the defendant. We're guilty, we're condemned, but Jesus steps in our place where he died in our place for our sins, and he was raised for our justification so that when we stand before God, we can be declared righteous and innocent, not because of what we've done. Our salvation does not depend on our works. Our salvation depends on the work of Christ and our belief in him as our Savior, so that we can stand before Christ, before God, as innocent and righteous because of Christ's death and resurrection for us. You see, this is the good news. This is the gospel. This is what we read in the call to worship in 1 Corinthians 15, that Christ died for our sins, that he was buried in the grave, and that he was raised again, all according to the scriptures. You see, the Bible is one book. It comes down to the resurrection of Jesus. And the scriptures, the Old Testament, points to the fulfillment of Jesus in the New Testament. It's all about Jesus. The resurrection is the crowning moment in the work of atonement provided by Almighty God for us. It's a work of the entire Trinity, which with each person of the Godhead acting for our salvation. So Jesus Christ is the risen Lord. Amen? Amen? And so we can say with confidence that Christ is risen. You see, you may reject him, but you cannot ignore him. The question for us is, how will we respond to the risen King and Lord of the universe? You can't avoid the question. That's what Easter is all about. It's not about bunnies and eggs, not about candy, not about wearing pastels. That was a good one, I guess, huh? It's about Christ and him being raised to life. So my hope and prayer is that you can say with all of us, Christ is risen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we praise you and thank you that you are alive. And we declare with joy and confidence that Christ, you are risen, and that by believing in you, we would have eternal life because you have come from heaven to earth to take us from earth to heaven. We praise you and thank you for your work of salvation and pray, Lord, that you would bless us as we seek to live lives that bring honor and glory to your name. For you, Jesus, are the King. And we want you to be the King over our lives, over every aspect of our lives, over every moment of our lives, so that you would be glorified and that we would be blessed. Because we know that true blessing only comes from knowing and trusting in you, Jesus, as our King. We pray this for your beautiful name. Amen.
Let's all stand and sing what it is the hosts of heaven are singing. God that he's alive.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we rejoice because you are alive, that you won, that you defeated death. And Lord, that gives us freedom, freedom from being enslaved to sin and to death, because you, Christ, are alive, and that there is hope and opportunity for redemption and restoration to you, our Father, because Jesus is alive. We praise you, Lord, and thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, church, go in peace. One last time, he is risen.